response, climate resilience, education, as well as food and water security. As the United States formulates and implements programs to support poor countries and the most vulnerable communities around the world, we must tap into the potential of people of African descent who are often most vulnerable and subject to disproportionately larger infrastructure gaps and are critical to catalyzing change, peace, and security, and also offers key opportunities to opening the door to economic opportunity within their communities and indeed around the world. And I've said this before, but I'll say it again. As we re-engage on the global stage, we must pursue connections that extend beyond just our traditional European allies and limited universe of partners. We, as a nation, must be far more inclusive in our outreach and engagement, especially as we seek to tackle global challenges that respect no borders. In doing so, the United States should closely consult with and leverage the strong relationships that exist among the African diaspora. We must tap into the cultural bonds that exist in so many minority communities across our nation, bonds that extend beyond borders. We not only do a disservice to Black and Indigenous voices when we exclude them from a seat at the decision-making table, we also hurt ourselves on the global stage when we fail to utilize and promote talent from historically marginalized communities or incorporate local perspectives. As our development agencies push to increase local engagement and use local partners, the United States and our G7 partners must ensure that our partnerships with people of African descent, both in public and private sectors, are developed with their leadership and expertise to craft and implement policy tailored to the needs of their communities. So today, we'll hear directly from leaders within the global Black diaspora, speaking from their experiences on the continent of Africa and Latin America and the Caribbean. And they'll speak on where we can best engage and foster economic partnerships. So I look forward to their thoughts on how we can deepen and strengthen inclusion in our development strategies and how we can leverage the global Black diaspora to scale our development initiatives and deepen impact, and how the United States can learn from the experience of these interconnected communities to strengthen our work around the world. But first, I now turn to Ranking Member McCall, who is the of the House Foreign Affairs Committee and who is co-leading this timely and important conversation for any opening remarks that he may have.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for inviting me to participate in this special roundtable for Black History Month. I have to brag on my, I represent Prairie View A&M. It's the second oldest public institution of higher education in Texas. It's a historically Black college, home to 9,000 students. They just recently attained the R2 Carnegie classification in recognition of their high level of research activity. And they also just got ranked as the top producer of African-American engineers in Texas. And so I'm very proud of Prairie View A&M and the good work they're doing. And also share your belief, Chairman, that America's national security apparatus needs to reflect America's diversity. And that includes our color of skin, gender, background, and diversity of thought. Since we are celebrating Black History Month, we should start by acknowledging the tremendous progress our country has made in addressing racial injustice. To cite one example, a young Black girl who grew up in a segregated Tuscaloosa, Alabama home went to on to become the America's 66th Secretary of State, Condoleezza Rice. And of course, we are participating at a roundtable hosted by this committee's first African-American chairman, Chairman Meeks. And it's truly an honor to serve with you, Mr. Chairman, and to call you my friend. The chairman and Secretary Rice's journeys are shining examples of our nation's progress. Unfortunately, injustice still exists here in America and around the world. And in recent years, America's civil rights movement has expanded beyond our shores and now involves the global Black diaspora. That diaspora is composed of individuals in countries all over the world. They share Martin Luther King's dream that all men and women, regardless of race, creed, or gender, are created equal, as did our founding fathers and Thomas Jefferson. In their home countries, these diaspora, they're fighting for the same rights that we've fought and continue to fight here at home. And it's engaged in the same struggles we are still grappling with in our nation. To remain a credible force for good, the United States must continue to serve as a model for what all nations should strive to become. I'd like to also take this opportunity to highlight some legislative efforts that advance these goals. As the business and economic backgrounds of our panelists suggest, leveraging the vibrant African diaspora community should be a key focus of U.S. trade and investment policy. And that's why I introduced H.R. 6455 to codify Prosper Africa, a whole of government initiative to increase two-way trade and investment between the United States and Africa. Since it started in June of 2019, the U.S. government has helped close over 800 deals across 45 African countries for an estimated $50 billion worth of exports and investments. This bipartisan legislation would explicitly require the United States government to engage with diaspora-owned businesses to identify investment opportunities in Africa. So I look forward to working with you, Mr. Chairman, and this committee to passing this important bill that will bring mutual economic benefits to the United States and to African countries. America's advocacy for human rights, international investment, and humanitarian assistance must never waver. And as we said during the Civil Rights Movement that America would no longer tolerate racial injustice at home, we must now say we will not tolerate global injustice abroad. And just as we stood up for Rosa Parks' right to sit wherever she pleased on the bus, we must now stand up for the Uyghurs' right to freedom from persecution. Just as we stood up for James Meredith's right to enroll at the University of Mississippi, we must stand up for Ukraine's right to self-determination, free of Russian interference. And just as we stood up for the marchers at Selma, we should stand up for Cuban dissidents rallying the streets for freedom, for Venezuelans who want their votes counted, and for Afghans because of the president's actions feel abandoned and without hope. But today I'm here and my staff are signed on to listen, learn from these panelists, like Linda Thomas Greenfield, who is serving our country so well in the international community with the United Nations. Very talented expertise. We share this common goal, Mr. Chairman, and I just want to thank you for hosting this roundtable today. And with that, I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. McCall. And now let me just introduce our roundtable guests. First, we have Dr. Vera Songwe from Cameroon, the Under Secretary General and Executive Secretary of the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa. She has extensive experience in pursuing microeconomic stability, development finance, and private sector finance on the continent. Then we're honored to have Dr. Claire Nelson, a Jamaican-American pioneer in engaging the global Black diaspora and the founder and president of the Institute of Caribbean Studies. She was recognized as a White House champion for change for her work on economic development, globalization, and issues concerning the Caribbean and its peoples, and is largely responsible for securing U.S. recognition of the National Caribbean American Heritage Month in July. And last, but certainly not least, we have Dr. Luna Ozemela, who of Rio Grande do Sul in Brazil. Dr. Ozemela is an economist, investor, and CEO of Development Impact Managers and Advisors, and co-founder of Global Leaders of African Descent. I now will turn to Dr. Songwe for her remarks.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, distinguished chairman. It is really an honor to be invited today to the Black History Roundtable event. And let me also respect and honor and recognize all the other congressmen who are and women who are on the call today. The United States remains the home of a lot of the diaspora around the world. Today, when we look around, we see that, you know, of all the diaspora, African diaspora that is diverse around the world, after Brazil, we have over 46.4 million diaspora of African descent in the United States. That is an important number. And of course, recognizing today Black History Month and bringing us together, I think touches all our hearts. Those of us who are of African descent and have lived in the United States. The United States remains, I think, the beacon of hope for many of the diaspora that come, the 46.4 million. We look to you to continue to strengthen economic ties with Africa, the motherland, as we would say. And I must start by saying that, you know, in a time following COVID, where we have all questioned the importance of multilateralism or whether multilateralism was still alive, we have seen in the new administration a strong re-engagement on the continent and with the diaspora. And I just want to start by recognizing that for us as Africa, we have always been calling for increased liquidity to help Africa grow out of this crisis. The Biden administration, of course, took the bold step to agree to the issuance of $650 billion of SDRs that was able to then allow us to begin to grow out of this crisis. We're still asking for on-lending of SDRs, and again, the United States administration, and we put it on your feet as congressmen and women to see whether we can approve the on-lending of SDRs that has been submitted to you, $15 billion of SDRs that the Treasury has done. We also really welcome the fact that the US, again, on the US leadership, took the first step in agreeing to the WTO TRIPS proposal to waive intellectual property rights and ensure that Africans could begin to build pharmaceutical industries, use intellectual property to cure their health, to address their health security. To date, the US has delivered about 150 million doses of COVID vaccines to Africa, the highest ever that we have seen. And I think, again, that ensures that we continue to build back. But beyond, I think, just building back on the health side, where Africa is sitting today and where Africa needs an incredible amount of attention from the United States is really in something that it's a win-win. Your small businesses, Africa's small businesses, your big business. These are the positive parts of the story. The not so positive parts of the story is that FDI from the United States into Africa has been dropping from $49 billion in 2014 to only 46 in 2021 before the crisis. That's a huge drop. It means that the private sector in the United States does not feel that Africa is a destination that they can come to. Whereas when we look at the African Continental Free Trade Area Agreement, and as Congressman Mix has said, we need $340 billion just in transportation, about $130 billion of that in airlines. Boeing, you are running the largest airline industry in the world. There is space and scope for better investment in rail, in roads. We believe that there is a lot more that can be done. Of course, on digitization, the continent is full of young people. By 2050, one in every four people in the world will be African. They need to be connected. They need to be digitized. I think some of the challenges that the United States is facing, trying to digitize the most remote parts of the country, are what Africa is facing as well. We believe we can share those experiences in a way that becomes a win-win. We have been talking with the Corporate Council for America, looking at how we can make sure that small Black businesses in the United States partner with small businesses in Africa to ensure that we actually together lift each other up, because there is so much exchange that can happen in those spaces. Yes, we talk about trade, we talk about AGOA. Exports from the Africa to the United States have dropped considerably, almost 30%. I know that we're all rethinking AGOA. AGOA has improved. There is a lot more trade that is happening in AGOA that is not energy trade anymore, but it is agriculture, it is textiles, but we need to strengthen that. We need to do more. Looking at how we can work together with institutions like DFC, I think is going to be critical for how we move forward. But paying attention, most importantly, to intellectual property rights, to the youth, to cybersecurity. I think when these bills come to Congress, when they come to you at your doorstep, looking at what part of it helps African American Black business. The minute you do that, you're also helping African businesses and African businesses in the diaspora. So I think that link remains very important, how we build stronger Black businesses in America so that those businesses can continue to come to the diaspora. One thing that, again, we continue to look at is remittances. Of course, all the Africans that are in the United States send remittances to the continent. In this crisis, remittances have been what has kept many of the Africans and many of the Black diaspora away from dropping and falling further below the poverty line. We need to ensure that remittance transfers are not costly, are not onerous, and do not become a negative transfer for those in the diaspora that are trying to send remittances back home. We call on Congress to look at some of the regulation around that to see how we can improve on that and ensure that it is equitable in that process. Finally, once again, we want to thank very much the United States for fighting and standing alongside Africa as we call for a carbon price. Climate change is the topic of the day. Climate change, we are spending almost 5 to 15% of our GDP responding to climate change effects. We believe that the initiative that the United States, along with the G7, as Congressman Meeks has emphasized, launched in Glasgow, in particularly for reforestation and to help South Africa get out of coal, are particularly important. But carbon pricing is really what the Africans are looking for. And if we can put a price to carbon, we can create 146 million jobs and begin Africa's rise back to recovery and to prosperity. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Songwei. Great remarks. We'll now turn to Dr. Nelson for her remarks.
Greetings and salutations. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, distinguished members of the committee or protocols observed. I want to thank you for this opportunity to lend my voice to the conversation on the Build Back Better World initiative. This unified vision for a global infrastructure development is very much in keeping with already agreed on global sustainable development goals. And so we in the diaspora in America express our full support for this conversation, this initiative as well, and trust we'll be able to work with Congress and the US federal agencies to reimagine the toolkit that is about development finance to ensure that those at the bottom half of the pyramid, the middle class and the working poor, especially those whose social safety net is remittances, as you heard, sent home by immigrant families working here in the front lines across America. Further, to ensure that this development finance accrues to the triple bottom line, which includes environment and social safeguards. We want to also say in the Caribbean context that this is a lifesaver. This conversation is a lifesaver and falls into the backdrop of the need for an updated US Caribbean strategy. As you might recall, Public Law 114291 called for every 3 years, US State Department to present to Congress a strategy of how US will engage with the Caribbean. And we have yet to see a renewed version of the last one done and submitted for 2020. So we hope that this will lead to that. Now, the Build Back Better initiative implies what I am calling a smart futures lens as a framework to design for all the interventions, be it policy-based lending or program initiatives and project initiatives across either the bilateral or multilateral finance agenda. So we're talking by smart, I'm talking about ensuring that we recognize we are operating in a complex system of systems framework, and we want to design programs which lend itself to sustainability. We want to ensure that we are working with metrics that matter, that we're moving away from 20th century measures of what success is and looking towards meaningful metrics that take account of things like equity and inequality in new ways that allow also participatory democracy to be deepened. We want to ensure that this investment supports anticipatory governance in these countries, bearing in mind the aspirations of all the stakeholders at the base of these countries as well, that we take into account robust resilience in their design against both the fault lines, which are man-made often by politics, as well as acts of God. And finally, transformational use of technology. So that's my five smart goals. So with this, we're talking about a smart Caribbean and need for what I'm calling new U.S. development compact that takes into account these goals and a smart Caribbean agenda that certainly, if we want to focus on three critical things, climate, health and health security and digital technology would be points of entry, building on what already exists in the marketplace of what the US is doing in the Caribbean region. I want to definitely point out for climate, we're talking about looking at an approach that recognizes climate impacts everything. It's talking about infrastructure, port infrastructure, airport infrastructure, tourism infrastructure, oil and gas in the Caribbean Sea, telecoms, fisheries, it all. And so I would like to propose that we look at establishing a US Caribbean Sea consultative group. This would definitely make sure we take care of the gap that currently exists, where we have the US Caribbean islands in the Caribbean Sea that are not part of the current Caribbean Sea Commission conversation taking place in the region. And I think such a consultative group will be able to look at both policies and technical and engineering issues if it includes public, private, and civil society, all the sectors, a transsectoral approach, treating the sea as one systems, and all these industries that impact being reframed and reimagined, and looking at the infrastructure needs to ensure long-term sustainability and health of the sea. This ties back into, therefore, our water and wastewater infrastructure. I would like to see that this infrastructure bill and financing look to see how we strengthen engineering partnerships. The US has some of the top engineering schools in the world. Yay, I'm a boilermaker. Let me just put out Purdue. I'm a boilermaker. And so I want to ensure that as an engineer, I see a stronger partnerships with US engineering infrastructure organizations, from the US Army of Engineers working to support strengthening of the defense community in the region to understand and engineer the challenges we're facing, as well as strengthening partnerships with HBCUs and other engineering schools that would support all the technical assistance needed to ensure that we're better able to also compete and participate in some of the procurement that is coming out of some of this financial spend that will happen. This ties back into health. I want to tell you point blank, the healthcare infrastructure in the Caribbean was shown and laid bare by the COVID pandemic. We're exporting doctors and nurses by the boatload to America. Every hospital across every state in America, I'm sure, has people from Caribbean working there at one level or another. However, the hospital management systems, healthcare management systems, biomedical system, lab systems are totally and woefully inadequate. I would like to see that we think through how do we increase U.S. partnerships. There's so many wonderful institutions, Institute of Industrial Engineers, and its training it does and certification it does. We can utilize already existing systems and bring them into the current foreign policy and development finance agenda in new ways. And I hope that this infrastructure bill and the money that will be spent to support the multilateral and development financing institutions, be it US Development Finance Corporation, AID, IAF, all the ones we have, look at new collaborations and partnerships. Digital infrastructure goes without a doubt to be the backbone of what we're looking for. We would not have survived COVID if we did not have increasing broadband access, and there needs to be more. Small islands, although small, sometimes have very high and deep hills and valleys, and we need to borrow from the lessons learned from the USDA rural electrification processes and all the different commissions already established to treat rural America that we can learn from and borrow to utilize. And I might add that there's a new movement of American islands that might be very useful to lend support, not just the Caribbean islands, but also to Pacific and African islands as well, who suffer from some of the same challenges. Finally, I want to talk about the metrics that matter. As we look about renewing and committing to new financing for development financial institutions, I want us to look beyond the growth gospel and look towards lifesaver economics. Look at the idea that we want to ensure that economic measures what truly matters. Are we measuring well-being that includes issues like vulnerability and or move towards a circular economy? Are we measuring things that really matter? Can we install a new thinking? Can we support through our executive offices in the IDB, in the World Bank, new thinking around development finance that also looks at the cost of development finance for small nations that are considered middle income, but just can't afford to purchase and buy things at the current interest rate? I want to close by saying that we in the Caribbean American diaspora are convinced that there's a clear and present need for continued strong and friendly U.S.-Caribbean relations. It's in our mutual interest. I see that this opportunity for deepening the infrastructure investment in the region by utilizing American engineering services, by increasing our trading investment and trading knowledge services, that we can deepen the engagement of civil society. And I would like to ensure that I include this idea of transparency and accountability. The Caribbean did not turn up too well on the transparency index, and we in the diaspora are very concerned and want to ensure that the civil society is strengthened and empowered and provided information and data to be part of the watchdog culture that we want to incur in the Caribbean region to diminish the amount of corruption that's happening in the Caribbean region. I can speak for my region and speak freely. We want to ensure that we see deepening and strengthening of civil society. In small communities, it's very hard to be a watchdog by yourself because everybody knows who you are and everybody knows where you live and you work for the same government you're trying to blow the whistle on. Whistle protection laws, strengthening of integrity commission. We, the Caribbean diaspora, want to push for that agenda and put it on the table as part of our way forward. Thank you very much for the opportunity to share these remarks.
Thank you, Dr. Nelson. And finally, we'll turn to Dr. Ozumula for her comments.
Thank you so much, Representative Mix. And I want to say good evening, everybody, and say that it's a great honor to be here and also share some thoughts on the challenges that are faced by the African diaspora in South America mainly. I must start saying that Latin America and the Caribbean, there are about anything between 135 and 150 million people who self-identify as Afro-descendant. And although Black people are mainly concentrated in Brazil, there are 114 million of those are in Brazil, improvements in national statistics now show that we are everywhere in the region. It's important to say that. In significant numbers, Black communities face both a humanitarian crisis and an economic one. I say humanitarian because this has to do with the massive death rates and killings of children and youth by the state and civilians, which require urgent international attention. But today, I'll turn to a key barrier the Latin Americans' advancement, which is the normalization of inequality and segregation of millions, turning the region into a very volatile, low growth, and low productivity one. So it's no news that Latin American faces, besides ingrained prejudice and discrimination, persistent racial disparities in the access to basic services and infrastructure. And I'll share some numbers. Black people in Brazil and in Colombia represent respectively 74% and 77% of the poorest in those countries. In Uruguay and Nicaragua, Black communities lack access to drinking water at rates which are double that of whites. In Colombia, predominantly Black cities are off the grid as they have internet access deficit of about 87% compared to 47% among the rest. So, and while gender wage gaps, which are important and around 30% in favor of men throughout the region, race wage gaps are around 40 to 50%, with larger gaps generally faced by more educated Afro-descendants, which is a tremendous contradiction. In Brazil, there are about 14 million Afro-entrepreneurs, and 37% are denied access to credit, while this rate for whites is 29%. In Mexico, 21% of Afro descendants use banking services. This is half the rate among whites and mestizo population. So racial disparities impose a threat to the achievement of the sustainable development goals. DIMA is working with the National Association of Development in Brazil in the 2030 National Plan for the Development Institutions. And in my conversation with numerous international development banks, I face challenges, which are that they do not see in many instances Brazil and some other Latin American countries as a priority anymore. That's because they use nationwide per capita income cutoffs that eliminate any possibility for the financing of Afro descendants within high income countries. Institutions such as the DFC, IFC, World Bank, IDB, all of them must pay special attention to communities within countries considered high income. They must disaggregate baseline data and evaluate their impact by race. So universal policies have had 130 years to prove themselves, and they failed to achieve meaningfully sustainable progress in addressing racial disparities in the region. So I propose we turn to two strategies: targeted universalism and economic self-determination as strong foundations for Afro descendants to be able to disrupt racist structures that underpin private and public investments in our region. The most well-known class of targeted policies, which are traditional, are affirmative actions. In Brazil, they were Black people's silent civil rights revolution that more than tripled the enrollment rates in only 10 years. However, Black students are still underrepresented in courses considered elite, which have a high demand also in the labor force, such as medicine, law, and engineering. And the United States has a role to play in influencing such laws to be implemented and in sharing knowledge and experience in countries like Colombia and strengthening existing laws, such as in Brazil. But targeted universalism is a concept developed by Professor John Powell, and it elevates the experiences of Black communities as an essential step to achieving universal goals. So targeted universalism must be expanded to entrepreneurship, to capital markets, to fiscal policies, which today are unfair to the Black population. For example, in the US assistance should be targeting Black-led communities and businesses, providing catalytic funds to investment readiness programs and seed capital to the diaspora, in line with its international goals, by making financial markets more diverse and inclusive. Now I want to turn your attention to self-determination. A serious self-determination issue is that Black people are not writing big checks. They are ready to do so, but they are excluded by financial markets completely dominated by white asset managers and asset owners. We need international support to create Black-owned development financial institutions, fintechs, and venture capital and private equity funds. USAID's Gender Lens Investment Promotion Program should also mainstream race in existing funds in the region and support Black fund managers. DIMA actively engages with capital markets and regulators in Brazil to have more accurate data on race in financial markets and on how to build, how we can build new financial instruments. Finally, there are hundreds of Black leaders around the world doing fantastic work to support the Black diaspora, technically and financially. So we conceptualized the global platform called Global Leaders of African Descent as a public good to unite Black-led ecosystem builders and plant the seed for global economic, for a platform, for solutions to be built upon and shared. Self-determination doesn't mean isolation, it means freedom, dignity, and respect in existing national and international structures such as the World Economic Forum, which does not provide today a space for Black leaders to also intervene. I celebrate the announcement of the policies that the United States has in terms of investment in infrastructure in the diaspora. The United States can certainly leverage the diaspora to strengthen its foreign policy, but first it will have to support the strengthening of the diaspora itself. So we will win by investing in the African diaspora. So thank you very much for the opportunity to address you all this night.
Thank you, Dr. Ozamela. As you can see, we had three tremendous briefers today, one from the continent of Africa, one from the Caribbean, and one from South America, all very, very, very important. I'll now recognize members for questioning. And I will ask everyone to be mindful of time to allow for a thoughtful and inclusive conversation, knowing that we have limited time also. And as so many of us, I want to get as many people as possible to engage in the conversation. And I think Angela, will be moderating. So she'll call on the witnesses for questions and be mindful of the 5-minute rule. I'll start by recognizing myself. And my first question will go to Dr. Songwei. Now, I have been a strong advocate for reframing and energizing U.S.-Africa commercial ties in a way that ensures our African partners have a voice and agency. And you helped launch a continent-wide private equity venture capital fund focused on incubating African women fund managers and investing in African women entrepreneurs. You're also a lead on implementing the African Continental Free Trade area, which you referred to as Africa's Marshall Plan. So my question to you is, real quickly, is how do you think that the United States can best implement, you know, support implementation of these ambitious African-led initiatives? And also, why is it so critical to specifically mobilize capital to African women businesses and investment leaders?
Should I go in now?
Yes.
Yes, no, thank you. Thank you very much, Congressman Meeks, Chairman. Very important questions. Women, the African Women's Impact Fund, it is called. It is no surprise that today talking to you are three Black women from the diaspora. And thank you very much for that. We recognize that. The idea behind the African Women's Impact Fund, and it's exactly what Dr. Luanda also spoke about, is we know 50% of all our populations are female-led. But as in the United States, as in Europe, and even worse on the continent, we only have 1% of Africa's women in fund management or equity management. This means there's a whole segment of the economy that just goes unseen because, yes, no offense to the men, but the men don't look at some of the growth sectors, some of the, you know, fast moving consumer goods sectors, which is the sectors where we really can create more jobs, where we can actually empower more women, and where there is, I think, opportunity for a lot more this B2B trade with the United States. So the whole idea behind the African Women Impact Fund was to say, can we have women at the table so that we can expand? When we talk about Africa, we talk about diversifying our economies. We see that with AGOA. AGOA is mostly oil for a very long time until we got more women into the businesses, and then we started diversifying into agribusiness and flowers. So the idea is how to diversify Africa's economies, we must empower women. And how do we do that? Is to put the decision making for businesses into the hands of women. So we hope we can do that. We hope that US businesses, DFC and AID and the rest can come to our come and support us in this initiative, because it works for both of us. On the African Continental Free Trade Area Agreement, it is indeed Africa's Marshall Plan. When you look at, you know, things from providing renewable energy to digitization, to education, to health, today Africa continues to import almost 96% of its health needs. If we began to trade with each other, we will ensure that Africa can create the jobs it needs. We can ensure that Africa can grow up the supply chain. One statistic that is important for America: when Africa trades with the United States, Africa adds more value. When the United States trades with Africa, Africa, it creates more jobs. So essentially it's a win-win for both of us. And we believe that as you begin to think of the sort of AGOA in 5 years, building an AGOA that leverages off of the African Continental Free Trade Area Agreement is the way to go. There is no other solution to that. From roads to ports, to digital, to healthcare, to skills, to education, we are going to be the technological engineers behind a lot of your factories. And so essentially ensuring that we have that knowledge and that we can trade that knowledge together is what the AFCFTA is about. It's not just about integrating Africa, it is integrating trade within the world and the global system. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me ask Dr. Ozamella a quick question. As you've indicated, nearly 200 million people who identify themselves as being of African descent live in the Western Hemisphere. Brazil with 54%, Colombia with nearly 23%. They have, as you also testified, some of the largest populations of African descent in the region. And despite strength in numbers, and it frustrates me at times, these communities of African descent are also some of the most excluded from access to opportunity, with the majority living at or beneath the poverty line. And I've been trying to work to make a difference there. So I'd like to ask you, how can the United States effectively advocate for programs in Latin America and guide public-private partnerships that support and leverage the unique talents and experiences of Afro-Latin Americans with the resources to increase socioeconomic mobility in the region?
Thank you, Chairman, for the question. In many ways, the strategy that the United States has taken in mobilizing significant amounts of capital in the region for certain issues that are priority to the United States have been through the multilateral development banks, to development banks such as the World Bank, the IDB, and other agencies where the United States has a stake on, right? By influencing corporate frameworks within those institutions and setting targets for lending to certain sectors, let's say climate change or green financing, et cetera, the United States can effectively influence the allocation of capital to certain sectors. And that was true for the issues of gender, that was true for the issues of climate change, green financing, energy, et cetera. So, and others related to infrastructure. So adopting a clear stance on driving capital allocation through development institutions could be a way to go. As I pointed out, however, some of those financial institutions do not look beyond the average of the national population incomes in order to prioritize countries, right? So there are certain quotas and allocations for various countries, and certain financial institutions have incentives for countries that considered low income or mid income countries. So countries like Brazil, for example, are excluded from such lines of financing because the financial institutions are looking at the average. So here the call is raise the instance of raise the priority of those funding, including disenfranchised and marginalized communities, as if they were countries themselves. that need financing independently from the income levels of a particular country. So that could be one way to go, one way to drive capital allocation through financial institutions. But of course, there are many shortcomings. There are many challenges that need to be overcome. There are experiences, for example, in Colombia with the Pacific Plan in the past, where financial development banks have not done a good job in delivering impact in those communities. To the opposite, many times it generates, the financing generates conflicts because the policies are ill-designed and do not account for institutional strengthening of the communities themselves. They only account for financing to strengthen departments within the Ministry of Finance or within the Ministry of Transportation, right? So what we need is effective monitoring by the community and strengthening within the communities themselves, possibly by creating and strengthening community development banks that are led and run by those communities.
Thank you for that. Let me now turn to Ranking Member McCall for his questions, after which Angela will call on the members.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was proud of this committee. We passed my Global Fragility Act to help stabilize Africa. you know, my question, you know, we passed the Development Finance Corporation into law, and I had a dinner with 8 African ambassadors about a year or so ago, and we were talking about the influence of China, and they're also very influential in Latin America and the Caribbean, you know, as well, and asked them why they were doing business with China and not the United States, and the answer is very clear, because they said, you're not here. The United States is not competing. And so a broad question, I guess, for all three, and, you know, my time's very limited right now, but we have the Prosper Africa Initiative. How would you rank the Development Finance Corporation, and what more can we do? I think passing the Prosper Africa Initiative would be helpful, but to really invest in these areas where we are in a global competitive struggle with China. Maybe perhaps.
Thank you, Ranking Member McCall. I think three things. And first of all, and let me commend the DFC. I think they came off the starting line very, very, very powerfully. But you need to do three things in the United States. The first one is accompany US businesses onto the continent. There is no sort of organized structure to do that. Many of your embassies do not have political or economic or commercial attachés that can give them the sort of intelligence of the ground. So you tend to read a lot of sort of communiques that do not reflect the truth on the ground, the bankable projects that exist, and there are many. And I think DFC is doing a fantastic job. The second one is maybe stand up a much faster institutions like US Exim Bank that are really important for trade. And I think the fact that sometimes it takes so long to know whether they'll get new funding makes it very difficult for a businessman to commit to them. And I think one needs to make sure that, you know, that conversation happens. I think finally, what we need to do is market access. The cost of market access on the continent is so high. No African business in the energy sector has defaulted in the last 20 years on any of its debt. But, you know, we tend to have very high investment cost. That is because there is not an accompanying system around it. One of the things that the US does well, and I think every African listening will agree with me, is the transparency of your investments. We know how much, we know the tenure, we know what is going to be the return, and we know how long. And I think that is welcome. But because you are not coming, you know, you create space. You know, nature abhors vacuums. And when there is a vacuum, somebody will close it. My sense is that when the US comes, the US brings technology, the US transfers information, but your systems, I think, still need to ensure that, you know, you can actually accompany US businesses onto the continent. I think there is some legislation that inadvertently makes it even more difficult for US businesses to come and working, as Congressman Meek said, with some of these legislations being inclusive, getting the Africans around the table to say, is this going to help you or is it not going to help you, is an important part of how we can make sure that US businesses can come on the continent in a way that makes sure that they can meet all their financial and fiduciary responsibilities back home, but continue to grow the continent and benefit their businesses and your investors. Thank you.
And sorry, those are excellent points. In the 1 minute I have left with the other two panelists, I'd like to very succinctly and briefly give their thoughts on this.
I would say on the Caribbean region, as you well know, well, you may not know, but there's a really huge conversation happening now. That many Caribbean people on the ground believe the same way, that there's a sell-off, if you will, because China is visible and it's easier. What we really want to see happen is more transparency. So to the extent, adding what has been said before, if we can see the US government making very clear and making very information available to Caribbean people, what the spend is, how it's being spent, and how much the governments are getting using technology in a wise way, this will help to strengthen the position of US businesses on the ground vis-a-vis what Caribbean private sector and civil society believe, and thus hopefully push the government towards the kind of transparency that we would like to see.
Thank you, Dr. Nelson. Dr. Osmela?
I think in this issue, the only thing I'll add is that in any action the U.S. Tries and to do within the region, is important to avoid this moral hazard issue that we have been seeing. For example, in the case of the Paris Accord, for example, where companies, American companies, wishing to get closer to forests, for example, where Afro descendants live in, right, in order to offset emissions, using their forests to offset emissions. However, these communities that today represent are sitting on the largest source of domestic carbon certificates that are going to be available for many years. But American companies need to have a way of being much more transparent on who they work with as independent evaluators, and also an oversight on how the projects are managed on the ground. It's not just to put the funds aside for a fund manager in Bogota, managing those resources and in the communities, not get involved in anything that is decided. So these are some issues that are more, let's say, operational, that needs to be on the minds and on the strategies of American companies moving forward.
Oh, thank you, Doctor. Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back.
We'll now turn to Representative Connolly for his questions.
Thank you so much. And thank you for being with us today, all three of you. I guess listening to the various iterations of Black diaspora in the Caribbean, in Africa, and elsewhere, my question is, could you talk a little bit about the impact of the pandemic on the Black diaspora? What's that mean for already struggling entrepreneurs, small businesses, and the Black diaspora community? I was particularly struck, Juana, by your data on Brazil and the great disparities that already exist in access to credit, investment, and the like. What did the pandemic do to that? And what special challenges are we going to be facing, and resources are we going to be needing to get out of it, to recover from it, because clearly it's had an impact?
Yes, indeed, Representative. The pandemic has created and magnified and magnified the problem that Afro-descendants were already facing in countries like Brazil and throughout the region. But in Brazil, where I'm much closer to it, and we have seen the data in terms of the death rates, we can see that although the death rates due to the pandemic have been similar between the two race groups, Afro-descendants have faced a much higher death rate among the younger population. And that's clearly due to the disparities in access to healthcare and access to services, basic services that Afro-Brazilians face today. And in terms of obviously all that has also, the pandemic has had a huge impact obviously on labor market outcomes. There are some studies that have shown that although Afro-descendants have not, let's say, decreased as significantly their participation rates, because despite the pandemic, they still need to work, the pandemic has had a huge impact on the level of incomes and wages in the labor force. And there are some studies by CEPAL as well that have shown that the rates of access to teleworking, for example, the number, the percentage of Afro families that can telework is half of those of non-whites that can telework. So all of that will see impacts on the, not only on the short term, but also on the long term, on the families and on the children, because mobility rates today are extremely low in Brazil. Just for you to have an idea, an Afro-descendant family, a person that is born in an Afro-descendant family of low education levels has 70% chance of staying in that same low level of education. So it's extremely immobile. So the pandemic, it's obviously worsening that situation. In terms of what can be done, current administration obviously has launched emergency programs. But in terms of what we see is the levels of vulnerability and poverty, which in Brazil we thought was, let's say, a problem that had been partially solved in previous administration, had been completely misled, because we went back to worse levels than before in terms of poverty reduction. So what we see is a population that extremely vulnerable to shocks and such as the pandemic. And what we need beside emergency programs is structural reforms in access in the labor market, fiscal policies, because today Afro-descendants are the ones that face fare worse in comparison to higher income populations in terms of the tax burden. So we need reforms that today are considered universal to elevate the targets related to Afro-descendants. So what I call the target universalism, these universal policies and reforms need to take into consideration Afro-descendants and put them at the forefront for us to solve and address those issues permanently.
I'm not sure at this time, but I just want to add on the Caribbean side, Haiti and Jamaica, are two of the biggest population countries in the CARICOM. So I'm referencing the CARICOM countries and in large part the Jamaican Haitian experience as two large countries with large amounts of poverty and deep amounts of poverty. I would say because of the reliance on tourism as one of the major foreign exchange earners. So remittances and tourism are the two large foreign exchange earners for the non-oil producing countries. So they have been decimated because the multiplier of families who lived off of tourism, either directly being employed or because they're employed by someone who's employed by the tourism sector, has created a ripple effect. What we're seeing now is, in addition to the continued vaccine hesitancy because of policies and cultural fears, we are seeing that with the increase of oil prices, the increase of basic price of flour, the food prices in Jamaica and Haiti are really beyond. There was an expectation that there would be a lowering of remittances because places like New York, for example, where we have a majority, and South Florida, where we have a majority of diaspora people, took such a big hit. However, those remittances have increased, yet you're finding, therefore, that the safety net of diaspora people here who are sending money back is also lowering. So we see a potential ripple effect. And if you look at the numbers of increasing violence in Haiti and Jamaica, certainly what many Jamaicans are fearing is what we call, unfortunately, a Haitification of Jamaica, of Jamaica. So we really are concerned that we can get some support for what we're talking about, this community-based development, community development banking, a return to focus on integrated rural development, and agriculture and agribusiness must be a key component of any reinvestment strategy to build back better. We must, of course, have food. A hungry man is an angry man.
If I may, Representative Connolly, a very good question. I'll give you three answers. I think the first one is financing. What we have seen, of course, is we didn't have that much of a hit on the COVID side. We didn't nearly have as many deaths as one would expect, but our economies collapsed. Every month of lockdowns cost us $69 billion. So one of the things that we need is really a reform of the global financial system. Because yes, we all asked and for special drawing rights, $650 billion were released. Africa got $33 billion. So it means essentially with $23 trillion of new liquidity injected into the developed world, you know, each developed world individual per capita got about $11,200 in terms of support or subsidy for the crisis. In Africa, we got $57, $11,200, $57. You don't need that much more. And so we are asking for unlending of SDRs. Secondly, a relook at global institutions who are well-intentioned to support. Institutions like Gavi, institutions like COVAX, the United States didn't get in, but later came in, and through it, we've gotten the 150 million vaccines. But these institutions sometimes are well-intentioned, but do not necessarily deliver for the continent. The continent is producing vaccines, but this institution to buy vaccines from India. Africa's health security is now in the hands of India. It should be in the hands of Africa. What the United States can do is exactly what you did, DFC investing in a South African pharmaceutical producing company, one in Kenya, one in Senegal. That's what we need. Support African institutions. The African Vaccines Acquisition Task Team should be strengthened and should be made permanent. And finally, on financing, we need, you know, the repo market, repurchase markets, increase liquidity into systems, into the United States. It's one of the reasons why the United States is now growing back better or growing forward better after the crisis. Africa needs financial institutions that responds to its needs and ensures that interest rates, today all we talk about in Africa is debt. But the problem with debt is because, one, we have a risk perception that's very high and we do not have mature enough financial institutions. We need to change the new global financial architecture so that Africa can ensure that it builds forward in a much more effective way. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for allowing the extra time for all of our witnesses to be heard.
Thank you. We'll now turn to Representative Cicilline for 5 minutes with a timer available for view on grid mode.
Thank you very much, Chairman Meeks and the ranking member. We'll call for this roundtable. And thank you to our witnesses for a really important testimony. I just want to ask Dr. Nelson, beginning with you, if you would. I know there's been some discussion for a very long time about the development of diaspora bonds and the notion of sort of post-COVID-19 with the necessity of significant additional investment and resources needing to be made available Do you think this model of a diaspora bonds are something we should consider? And in addition to that, how would the diaspora ensure that the financing that they would provide were going to the areas of most need or the projects of greatest need? And is that something worth looking at?
I would definitely say that a diaspora bond, as we conceptualize it, not as the government conceptualizes it, is something worth looking at. I think we are very interested in not these big bonds that the government does have funds to play around in. We want to do bonds that are targeted to what we call probably the hot zones, where we see rising in rural areas where we didn't expect it, rising violence, where there's opportunity because there's a lot of arable land, there is things that could be done and grown and developed there. So we would see support for community development bonds that not only focus on high net worth Caribbean individuals. Yes, we have a lot of successful high net worth Caribbean individuals on the West Coast in fintech and all of that stuff, but we have a lot of diaspora who are middle class earners who may only be able to put in 500 or 1,000. And there are samples of such workable community development programs already in test market. Unfortunately, the World Bank studies have not looked at those. So I would propose that there needs to be a rethinking of what the World Bank has studied and take into account what the average diaspora person, such as myself, thinks about these things.
Thank you. And Dr. Ozamana there, one thing that I'd like to hear some more about and some thoughts on are the ways that people-to-people ties between American Afro descendants of Latin America and Afro-Latinx communities in the Caribbean might be used to really help promote human rights. Because as you know, the Caribbean maintains some of the most discriminatory laws against the LGBTQ community in the world. And according to the Open for Business Coalition, maintaining them costs these countries $4.2 billion a year due to diminished human capital, health disparities, labor output, experiences of violence, and obviously constraints on tourism. How can American companies make a case for LGBT equality in economic terms, and how can the diaspora help in that effort?
Thank you, Representative, for the question. I've worked on developing ESG, environmental and social safeguard frameworks for the private sector. And one of the things that I see very, very promising is the use of certain principles and guidance for American corporations on how to create safeguards within their operations entering the region. There's one example is when we talk about incorporating gender and LGBTQ rights within those frameworks is when you are participating in governmental bids, for example. How do you, let's say, operate within a framework that is discriminatory, right? And it's always important to remember that although there are the national laws, there are also international standards. So activities, for example, when you are providing seeking for land and seeking for to build real estate property where denies the rights of same-sex families to apply for those, for example, real estate properties, you can use international frameworks and standards to support your policies. But I think there is also an important point in terms and important work that the US and the World Bank has been doing in making it visible the countries that are still have a long way to go through the Women in Business report, which ranks governments in terms of how discriminatory their legislation us are, I think it's important to make it visible, to be there, and also continue the effort of advocating and dialoguing. And from the side of the private sector, it's important to design strong ESG frameworks to work with, aligned with international standards.
Great, thank you so much. My time has expired. I have lots more questions, but I'll yield back.
We'll now turn to Representative Liu for 5 minutes.
Am I in queue?
Yes, Representative Liu, you're for 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you. So first of all, thank you, Chairman Meeks, for putting together this important roundtable, and thank you to the excellent panelists and your presentations. I want to follow up on what Representative Connolly asked about the pandemic, and it's specific to vaccines. So this committee in Congress, we passed legislation to make sure we vaccinate as many people worldwide as we can. The U.S. has been a leader in vaccine distribution worldwide, including to countries in Africa, the Caribbean, and South America. My question has to do with articles I started reading about disinformation in a number of these countries. So in South Africa, there are a number of articles came out that said it wasn't so much that South Africa didn't have vaccines. It was that folks are getting disinformation, similar to kind of disinformation we're getting in the US. So I have two questions. One is, do you agree with that? And is that happening in other regions of the world as well? And second, if it is, how can the US better assist and counter those efforts?
Thank you, Congressman Liu. I think that is for me. Three things. One, well, we have done studies, independent studies have been conducted that show that 82% of Africans, if vaccines are available, are willing to take them. I think, again, under the African Vaccines Acquisition Task Team, Africa has been procuring vaccines, including for our Latin American and small island states in the Caribbean. So, and there is need for them. Where we are looking for more resources, again, and we've asked, and maybe with the United States working with the IMF to create a vaccines facility, is we are finding out that it's no longer a lack of vaccines, it's a lack of resources to conduct vaccinations. Because of course, Africa is a huge continent, and just, you know, oil prices are now the highest they have been in 7 years. To take, you know, vaccination clinics out further afield in the Sahel costs just as much as financing education. So I think that is where the resources are now needed. 82% of Africans want vaccines. We're working with the World Bank to see whether we can try to improve on vaccinations by ensuring, one, we're getting vaccines, but we're not getting the PPE equipment that is needed. The syringes are not coming, the gauze is not coming. That's what is really needed today. And so I think, again, if we could get a vaccines facility in the IMF using some of the SDRs to help facilitate, all through the World Bank, to help facilitate the vaccination process, it will be important. Thank you.
Thank you, that's very helpful. And maybe Chairman Meeks and your staff, we could look at whether we can tweak language so that money can also be applied to getting the vaccinations done, not just the vaccines themselves.
Thank you, that's really useful.
And with that, any other panelists can present it, but that's my last question, and thank you.
Yeah, just to say particularly one issue from the Caribbean perspective is that because of the fact that there was a sort of a disregard of traditional healthcare approaches and medicines for use as prophylactics, for example, in terms of cannabis. Cannabis research in the Caribbean is well established. It's well established that emphysema and other lung treatments are possible. And so because people didn't see investments and any support for local researchers, it heightened this kind of feeling that this is being thrust down our throat by some foreign interests that may want to kill off Black people the way they deal with other unknown diseases. And so until there is this sense that there's a research equity, financing research equity in developing countries, non-traditional herbs and medicines, there's going to always be a vaccine hesitancy. And I would like to see in this next round that there's some support to research and development equity for those medicines that have been tested in these countries in Africa and Caribbean region.
Thank you.
I must just mention that COVID-19 relief funds, I know your question was on vaccine, but it's important to mention that these relief funds provide a very good opportunity also to support Black-owned businesses that will create the base, not only create employment, but also they'll also create companies that provide goods and services to the health system, like the med techs. And we are seeing a huge increment of the participation of Black-owned businesses in that sector of the med techs, the health techs, because Black graduates are graduating at a high rate in the nursing courses and medical related fields more and more. So we see an increased number of clinics that private clinics that are led by Black entrepreneurs. So it's important that to take into account that the relief fund, beside the vaccine, besides the medical equipment, also perhaps think of how to support businesses that serve this sector.
Great, thank you, and I yield back.
Our last question will come from Representative Jacobs. Representative Jacobs, you have 5 minutes.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair, for hosting this important roundtable, and thank you to our panelists. Our USAID Administrator, Samantha Power, is really leading an agency-wide push for inclusive development, noting in November of last year that becoming more attuned to the voices and needs of those we aim to help is necessary to beat back the threats of COVID-19, climate change, corruption. So I wanted each of you to talk about what inclusive development looks like for communities within the global Black diaspora and which types of partnerships are most desired or effective.
Thank you, Representative Jacobs. I think the first one is, as Chairman Meek said, it has to be inclusive. You have to listen to the voices of those that one is trying to help. Otherwise, as Nelson Mandela said, whatever you do for me, but without me is against me. So this is a really powerful. I think secondly, of course, the most the community that needs the most inclusion is first of all, in Africa, is first of all women and then the youth. And so designing programs, I think around those two is going to be particularly important. And finally, when those programs are designed, most of them have to do with access to financing. And I think USAID is one of the most attuned to sort of the African finance and private sector community. We must go back to sovereign rates. If sovereign rates are too high, local interest rates become onerous and impossible to achieve. So looking at how one can reduce interest rates through different mechanisms, either by creating new instruments or by enhancing the existing instruments through blended finance opportunities or things like that, is particularly important. I think that is where the focus should be. Thank you.
Quickly, I just want to add that I would think in a Jamaican and Caribbean context, this inclusive, when I look at inclusive development and prosperity at an end game, I see the dismantling of the garrison communities that lead to endemic violence and poverty, that these numbers and communities have not shifted for the last 60 years. Jamaica and Trinidad turned 60 this year, and we still have the same places that were poor 60 years ago are still poor today. So we want to see for sure a focus on the rural and inner city poor to have access to information, access to education, access to finance through community empowered programs, not ones which are necessarily controlled by the members of parliament that therefore keep them in a circle of obeisance, you know, to the politicians as the new dons of these areas. It's very important that we break this cycle so that participatory democracy can truly flourish.
Yes, if I may add, inclusive development, for it to be sustainable, no, permanent, we should be talking about mobility and we should talk about wealth creation. We should perhaps avoid giving too much emphasis to income, which is transient, volatile in the face of crisis like the ones we have been living. So, and in order for us to create wealth within Black communities and diaspora communities, we need to create entrepreneurs and we need to strengthen their companies. Wealth does not come by having a low-income job. Wealth comes by buying and selling companies and making wealth. It's what propels families to getting out of a vicious cycle of poverty. Just to give you an example, SoftBank invested in the first unicorn led by a Black person in Brazil. It made a revolutionary shift in the mindset of people in Black communities in Brazil. There is a possibility. There is a model that we can follow. And it was supported by an American company. So I truly believe there are partnerships that must be established that should be focused on wealth creation and social and economic mobility.
Well, thank you so much. And Mr. Chair, I yield back.
Thank you. Thank you so very much. Let me thank the witnesses as we close out. I think this was a very, very important discussion. And today we clearly saw that there's not only a critical need for the United States engagement with the Black global diaspora, but there's a need for more discussions like these, which we know that can help us lead and will lead to viable actions. And it's also through conversations with leaders like our esteemed panelists, we can effectively partner to catalyze investment into an untapped potential of this global community to partner and invest effectively. I was tremendously impressed about talking about the investments that can go in and how to do it and how to reshape the global economy as a result of making sure that the continent, the South America and the Caribbean are not left out. So with initiatives to increase diversity at our federal agencies, which we can do, we gain strength as a nation when we engage and foster the talents of people of African descent and Black-owned led institutions, as well as in local community engagement. The global Black diaspora is full of important opportunities, and if we're to be successful in leading on the international stage, we cannot fail to foster its growth and leverage it to tackle global generational challenges. And I'd like to end with the quote that Ms. Songwe said of Nelson Mandela. It's something that I'm gonna utilize again and again and again, because it is true. You know, you have folks come in, but whatever you do for me, without me, is against me. And I think that is something that needs to be recognized and listened to, and the wisdom of the late, great President Nelson Mandela. With that, thank you all very much, and travel safely. And at this point, this briefing is now adjourned.